But here is a worrying fallout of this entire citizens list row. Now, similar demands are growing in other northeastern states. In Meghalaya, for instance, videos have emerged since last night showing Khasi Students Union activists stopping travelers who are coming in from Assam and then interrogating them about their citizenship status. In fact, all northeastern states have now increased their border vigils, fearing that immigrants will try to sneak in. My colleague Ratandeep Chaudhary has this report.
These videos shot by passengers travelling on the road from Guwahati to Shillong in the last 2 days have gone viral on social media. The visuals show members of the powerful Khasi Students Union stopping passenger vehicles and checking credentials of people entering Meghalaya, a spillover effect of Assam's citizens register.
As Assam tries to deal with the fallout of the draft NRC, other states in Northeast are also on the edge. Neighboring Meghalaya has stepped up its vigil along the border with Assam. And in Meghalaya as well, illegal influx is a major issue for years together.
Time and again, the union has apprehended numerous illegal immigrants who tried to infiltrate through various porous border.
In Meghalaya, the issue of migrants has always been a source of conflict. The government, however, says no private organization will be allowed to conduct any checks.
It would not be appropriate for any non-government agency to involve themselves in this process. We have in fact set up different checkpoints in different locations. I have personally been monitoring the matter in the last 2 days.
It's not Meghalaya alone. Nagaland, Arunachal Pradesh and Mizoram have stepped up check on the border for the inner line. A permit or the ILP, a special document, is required for non-domicile to enter these states. The Lok Sabha MP from Silchar in Assam, Sushmita Dev, has written to Union Home Minister Rajnath Singh complaining of harassment of people from Assam while travelling through Meghalaya. Meanwhile, members of the Khasi Students Union say they will soon meet Meghalaya's Deputy Chief Minister Preston Tinsang to request a national register of citizens for the state. With Ratnadeep Chaudhary in Nongpo in Meghalaya, Rohit Wellington for NDTV.
So quite apart from the political battle, which is very obvious as that plays out, the question is, are genuine Indian citizens being harassed as this entire process plays out? And joining us on the program this evening, we have Manish Tiwari, former Union Minister and Congress spokesperson, Mr. Deshratan Nigam, member of the RSS, and he's of course a lawyer as well. Dr. Garga Chatterjee is a supporter of the Trinamool Congress. Mr. Ranjan Bhattacharya, well-known political analyst, is here with us in the studio. But I'd like to go first tonight to our guests who are joining us, in fact, from Guwahati. There is Mr. Muhammad Ajmal Haq, who has retired from the Indian Army after serving in the Indian Army for 30 years and finds his name not on that citizens list. Also, Sadullah Ahmed, who's retired from the Indian Air Force, finds himself in the same situation. Mr. Haq, if I could ask you first, in your case, you know, you've spoken about this also in the last few days. I mean, here you are, someone who's retired from the Indian Army, having served for more than 30 years. You had submitted all your documents, including your mother's NRC document, your father's data, etc., and you're still in this predicament.
मैंने जो एनआरसी फॉर्म फिलअप किया उसमें हमने हम क्लियर डॉक्यूमेंट दे दिया है. मेरा मदर का 1951 का एनआरसी डॉक्यूमेंट लेगेसी वो दिया हुआ है. उसके बाद मेरा फादर का 1966 जो लेगेसी डाटा है वो हमने कंप्लीट दिया हुआ है. लेकिन इसके बावजूद भी जो इन्होंने चेक किया है, फैमिली ट्री चेक किया है, एवरीथिंग चेक किया है, सब हम जाकर के उसमें रिक्वायर्ड प्रेजेंटेशन दिया हुआ है. लेकिन इसके बावजूद भी हमारा फैमिली में अभी 10 आदमी का नाम आया हुआ है और 10 आदमी का नाम नहीं आया. तो ऐसा है, हर एक जो अभी आउट ऑफ 40 लाख जो बोल रहे हैं ये इलीगल माइग्रेंट्स है, तो इसमें जो है ना हर एक घर से 2 आदमी का आया, 3 आदमी का नहीं आया, 4 आदमी का आया, 5 आदमी का नहीं आया, ऐसा ऐसा कहानी है. तो मैं ये सोचता हूँ जे ये हम अभी फेथ ही हमारा उठ गया है, हम कैसे फेथ करें, जो कि हमारा जो प्रॉपर डॉक्यूमेंट है सब कुछ ओके है. 1945, 1947 मेरा जो फादर का लैंड डॉक्यूमेंट है वो है. इवन माय मदर 1951 एनआरसी में इंक्लूड है. तो उनका इतना डॉक्यूमेंट होते हुए भी हमारा जो है ना एनआरसी में फाइनल ड्राफ्ट में नाम नहीं आया.
लेकिन आयरनी
तो इसलिए
तो
हम बहुत ही अपसेट है और बहुत चिंतित है.
आप चिंतित हैं, लेकिन इसमें आयरनी ये भी है कि आपने अपने इंडिया को सर्व किया है, अपने देश को सर्व किया है, आपने आर्मी में सर्विस दी है, 30 साल से ज्यादा आपने सर्व किया है आर्मी में, और ये आपका हाल है आज. कि आप एज पर अमित शाह यू आर एक्चुअली ऑलरेडी एन इलीगल इमिग्रेंट बिकॉज दैट इज वॉट यू सेड यस्टरडे.
या इस बात को अगर अब हमको बोलने के लिए बोलेंगे तो मेरा दिल टूट चुका है. मैं रोता हूँ अभी. मेरा बाल बच्चा जो है ना बहुत दुखी है क्योंकि 30 साल देश के सेवा देने का बावजूद भी मेरे साथ ये सलूट है. और ये नहीं है, इससे पहला भी जो है ना मेरा नाम पे कोई डिबूटा नहीं था. मैं कंटिन्यू वोटर लिस्ट में हूँ. मेरे को डाउटफुल फॉरनेस बोल के नोटिस इशू किया था पिछला साल नवम्बर में. मेरा मिसेस को मुमताज बेगम उनको जो है ना 2012 में नोटिस इशू किया गया था. फिर भी वो हम ट्रिब्यूनल में गया, वो इंडियन सिटीजन बोल के डिक्लेयर हुआ. मेरा जो छोटा भाई उनका बीबी उनको भी जो है ना डाउटफुल फॉरेनर्स बोल के नोटिस इशू किया था. तो ये सब इलीगल जो मैं लांछना भोग रहा हूँ, बहुत ही हराश हो रहा हूँ. और मैं अकेला नहीं आए, बहुत सारे आदमी ऐसे ही इलीगली हराश हो रहे
हैं.
तो इसके लिए जो है ना हमारा बहुत दिल दुखी है. और जो
जी आपके आपके साथ सदुल्ला अहमद बैठे हैं
जो इस असम में आए.
मैं सदुल्ला अहमद साहब से पूछना चाहती हूं कि आपके केस में क्या हुआ? आपने भी तो अपने डॉक्यूमेंट सबमिट किए हैं, तो आपके केस में आपका नाम कैसे लिस्ट में नहीं है? आप तो एयरफोर्स से रिटायर हो चुके हैं.
ओके मैम, माय एल्डर सिस्टर, या आई हैव टू पुट 20 इयर्स सर्विस इन इंडियन एयरफोर्स. 2009 I have retired from the Indian Air Force. 20 years after putting, due to my elder sister, fourth numbers, he was tag as D, and we challenged in tribunal, then higher court, then Supreme Court. Due to her, because she also used my father's legacy, my name is Holt. My two sons, myself and my sisters, elder sisters, name hold in NRC, could not figure in the NRC. Due to the deep water tag against my sister, one of the my sisters.
But you know, this is the irony. Hello? And Manish Tiwari, I wanted to begin with these gentlemen because here are two gentlemen who have served India, who have served their country. As members of the army and the air force, and we're at this situation today where they are not on this list, where they, as I said earlier, the BJP president has already declared these 40 lakh people as illegal immigrants even before they get a chance to go through the process and appeal.
Well, Nidhi, you're absolutely correct. It is indeed most unfortunate. At times the cure turns out to be worse than the disease. While it is a fact that Assam has had a historical problem with migration going back to 1826 when Assam was annexed and merged with the Bengal presidency, and subsequently there have been various waves of migration, primarily after the partition and then after 25th of March 1971, when the Pakistani army unleashed a genocide in what was then East Pakistan, which led to many people fleeing across the border. But the fact remains that this process is completely flawed. It's not about gender or religion or caste or linguistic minorities. What you find is that across the board, you have families which have been divided, as this gentleman was correctly explaining. Three people from the family figure in the draft NRC, five people have been left out. So we can only hope that when the objections start from the 30th of August till the 28th of September, they will be dealt with in a sensitive manner, and this 40 lakhs will ultimately come down to something which is a far more reasonable number. But presuming even if this 40 lakhs comes down to, let's say, 4 lakhs, and you declare 4 lakh people to be stateless, where are you going to send them? Bangladesh is not going to take them. Bangladesh has already said it is India's internal problem. First of all, even under the Foreigners Tribunal, you'll have to establish their nationality, that they belong to a country other than India. Then the question is that country ready to accept them? So essentially, you are saddling with yourself with a problem where nobody is going to accept these people, and you're going to have an X number of people who will be stateless.
In fact, it will be the world's largest stateless population process. If this
And then there is a larger question of
No, sorry, Manish, just one second. I want to ask Mr. Deshratan Nigam.
No, no, may I just complete? And
Okay, go ahead. Yeah.
And Nidhi, then there is the problem. You know, India is a signatory to the International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights. You know, India is a signatory to various human rights conventions. At some point in time, this is going to get internationalized, and it's going to become extremely embarrassing, maybe more embarrassing than the UN Human Rights Council report, which has just come out on Kashmir, which this government has been completely unable to either contest or rebuke.
No, and everything Manish Tiwari listed, Mr. Nigam, I'm sure you can't disagree that these are genuine concerns. You're hearing these two, you know, gentlemen there talking about, you know, how literally heartbroken they are at what they're having to go through. The other concern is, as Ratnadeep's story showed, is how now groups are taking matters into their own hands in neighboring states and, you know, checking citizens who are traveling from Assam. You know, they're not going to wait for a Supreme Court order. There is a real danger that this could really flare up.
Let us be very clear between the process and the concept. Concept of NRC is perfect, and it is there to, you know, determine the genuine citizens of India. Thereby, the natural fallout would be who are not citizens of India. So we may have issues with the process, not with the concept of NRC.
That I think the Congress would agree with you.
And therefore, there may be issues, with, as you said, presuming that these gentlemen are right. I'm presuming because I have no other way of verification. So presuming they have a process and they will have to go the process, there have been issues. The family tree, the concept of the family tree that was used here, really brought out certain discrepancies among a lot of people because they were not able to establish the family tree. And the other problem that also arose was the Bengal became the biggest defaulter state where the document verification was sent, and they only returned 6% of the documents. So the process, we have to streamline this process. Let us be very, very clear. And that process.
It's not just a question of streamlining. I mean, this is being monitored. These people who have been left out of this list, in a way, have a target on their backs. When Amit Shah calls them illegal guspethi, when he says that they are infiltrators even before they've had a chance to appeal and go through that entire process, then it is literally like having a target on your back.
No, I haven't heard Mr. Amit Shah, but the fact remains.
It was a very widely reported comment
yesterday.
But
the fact remains, any illegal immigrant will only be declared so only after the entire process is complete. We all are aware of it being monitored by the Supreme Court. Every month the reports are given. So that process is on, and we cannot stop that process. We have to identify, because illegal immigration has to be disincentivized.
Yes, but genuine citizens shouldn't get hurt in the
process. Yes, yes, yes. Obviously.
Garga Chatterjee, you're raising your hand.
You do not have to give premium or incentive to illegal immigration.
So Garga Chatterjee, you're raising your hand. We're seeing also this very sort of ugly altercation at the airport in Silchar between TMC MPs, no less, who've now been placed under arrest, as well as the police there. But how do you react to the fact that, you know, you now have TMC leaders from Assam, three of them, including the state chief, who have put in their papers today saying that they don't actually agree with Mamata Banerjee's scaremongering on this?
The party, state party unit had been reconstituted quite a few months ago, and was to be reconstituted, and it had been broken a few months ago. Himanta Biswa Sarma, he has engineered some kind of a sideshow so that it takes us away from what very serious matter that has happened today. In Assam, seven districts are under Section 144. Cabinet Minister of West Bengal, which is a neighboring state of Assam, and also MPs from Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha have been beaten up, including Sukhendu Shekhar Rai, who has a pacemaker, including Mamata Bala Thakur, who is the leader of Dalit Bengali Hindus, who now appear in huge numbers in this NRC so-called foreigner list, and they have done rail roko all over Bengal today. So we must actually disabuse ourselves out of three things which are being said. It's not a Muslim only issue. There has been ethnic targeting. There has been targeting of folks who do not vote for the BJP. And also the fragile piece of the variegated situation of Northeast has been broken asunder. You can see it now. As you said, there are vigilante groups asking Bengalis for their papers. Secondly, they are talking about how can you question the Supreme Court. Well, the Supreme Court was not there in the ground. In the ground, there were state government employees and lots of non-permanent and contractual people who were from ASU, BJP and RSS, who basically then used, to my third point, very different standards for determining citizenship. So-called OI category, by which core voters of BJP were given a free pass, and a parameter used for other people, primarily Bengalis and Gurkhas, who mostly have ties with West Bengal. They have used a parameter by which 50% of the population of India, especially poorer and low-caste people, will be rendered stateless, citizenshipless.
But Mr. Chatterjee, while you make some important points, can I ask you that, can you just dismiss the sort of discomfort even within the TMC on Mamata Banerjee's position as just Himanta Biswa Sarma's, you know, big conspiracy to try and turn the Trinamool against each other? Because, you know, even the Congress yesterday said on this program that they don't agree with her statement of saying that there will be a civil war and a bloodbath. Is she sounding a bit alarmist there, is the question.
I think Congress, for whatever reason, does not recognize, I think, does not think that BJP is trying to precipitate a civil war. Mamata Banerjee said that if BJP continues to do what it does, it is trying to lead the country into a civil war. And when you have a certain community or certain groups of communities in the northeast of India, very security-wise important place, setting up vigilante groups, hardening state borders, what exactly does it look like?
Okay, let me get Mr. Rajan Bhattacharya here.
And this person who is the so-called Trinamool chief, this person's name nobody heard till yesterday.
This is a complete
Himanta Biswa Sarma kind of dirty trick department thing. His wife's channel was actually showing any live. Name of the channel was showing that Trinamool MPs with pacemaker apparently were beating up Assam police. I mean, this is the... BJP is conducting a war against reality. There was an assault on the police. We have seen quite a scuffle at the airport. You could see the pictures of the officers who were also assaulted, as well as what was happening the other day. Mr. Bhattacharya, the point is
I don't want to focus so much on the scuffle at the airport, because that's not the issue here. The issue here is what happens to people, and is there a real danger that this could actually flare up?
Well, I strongly believe that the ruling party of the day, inside the parliament and outside the parliament, the way they took it up, the NRS issue, this is not the way to handle. You know, there is a process is ongoing, and there are under the supervision of the Supreme Court. Now, that is one area of activities. And the second area is the political. On the floor of the parliament, the responsible leader of a ruling party's president is stating that what Congress party has not been able to do, we have done. That is one aspect of it, which is absolutely wrong statement. It is the duty bound of the government of today. What the previous government has done, it has to be completed. It is to be just executed. There is no question of either you totally scrap it and make it a free phrase issue and do it in your way. That is one way of doing it. The second point is political excitement, and the situation is going beyond control, and all that is being talked by the media. But I'd like to tell you that all this is to a great extent being created by the BJP's MLAs and MPs. The BJP's MLA have stated openly in media that the illegal immigrations are to be shot dead. People should be thrown away. Is this the way of responsible people's representative should make a statement like that?
I think that's a valid point, Mr. Nigam, that there has to be some restraint. The restraint can't just be shown by Mamata Banerjee. She has to, of course, perhaps do that. But that some of these comments really have been.
I think there should be restraint on the part of every political party. This is not a political issue. Let's not make it a political issue.
illegal immigration is a very serious issue all over India. Assam is just an example.
But it is a political issue. It was part of the BJP's campaign in 2014.
In fact, it was part of the manifesto of Congress also.
Yeah, exactly. And everybody. So it's very much a political issue.
No, it's not. It was on the basis of principles that they had decided. Now the politics is coming into play, which should not. And look at the kind of Mamata Banerjee says bloodbath and civil war, and therefore these MPs were prevented from entering Assam.
But why were they prevented? They're members of parliament. I mean, fine, this is their own country, for God's sake.
No, it's fine.
Why should they be arrested?
Because there
was
a chance of inciting violence because of the supreme leader said so. And therefore inciting violence, and there was a possibility of violence, and therefore they were stopped. And the way they behaved at the airport was something that they were predetermined to create some kind of a law and order issue. And it is preemptive on the part of the government.
Okay, so you're saying it was done deliberately, Garga. One second, Mr. Bhattacharya.
I like to make one point very clear. This is my understanding that Mamata Banerjee's statement with regard to bloodbath and all that issue is purely her apprehension. She has never said that she is going to incite this kind of a situation in the country. Politically, what can happen? And as a political leader and as a responsible leader of a political party and chief minister of a state, it is her moral duty to point out what she thinks, and that is what she has stated.
Just five seconds.
Her statement had the potential of the highest level of violence.
And what about the BJP guy who said, let's shoot the immigrants dead?
So he should be booked himself. You know, both the people need to be booked. Nobody has a right to make this kind of statements.
Okay.
Let us behave responsibly.
Okay. Garga Chatterjee?
I think why the RSS ideologue or person is distorting Mamata Banerjee's statement. She never said she wants Bhatpar. She says BJP
she
is leading the country towards a bloodbath.
I never said
war.
So. I said
very
the potential of creating highest level of violence.
Then why should she be booked? She should be booked for actually stating what might be BJP's political goal. She should be booked for critiquing the BJP. Having said that, Trinamool did not bring all this police force to the airport. Trinamool did not detain the MPs. Trinamool did not put Section 144. Trinamool did not make Indian citizens refugees in their own land. Trinamool did not do ethnic targeting. What are we talking about? BJP is very nervous right now. Because if people who have been muzzled in Assam, if they rise up, BJP will be in serious crisis. And
you
that
know,
is why these people have been retained, Trinamool MPs and MLAs.
Manish, can I just ask you that does the Congress still, you know, stand by the principle of what the NRC was meant to do? Or, you know, do you think that the party's position can evolve from there? There has also been an argument ever since this happened over the week that, you know, India also is a country that has now embraced people from outside, as many Western democracies have done as well. And, you know, now to throw people out, descendants of people who were born here in the 80s, etc., 90s, you know, it's not becoming of the world's largest democracy. Is there any sort of nuance, any change in position that the Congress sees on the principle of this?
Nidhi, let me make three points quickly. You know, first of all, immigration all over the world is a deeply political issue. So if anyone wants to delude themselves into believing that immigration is not a political issue, with great respect, they're living in cuckoo's land. Number two, look at the oxymoron. Here we have a particular position with regard to alleged illegal immigration. There are thousands of Indian youth who are detained on the US-Mexico border, you know, by the United States government because they illegally crossed into the United States of America. Then why is the government of India providing consular assistance to them? Why is the government of India been providing consular assistance to all the people who've illegally immigrated to European countries? The fact is that immigration has been a historical reality. You know, people have gone in, the people have gone around in search of livelihood, in search of a better living, out of persecution. So therefore, immigration, unfortunately, whether you like it or not, you know, is a fact of life. And number three, you know, coming to your specific question, look, the NRC process emanates out of a public interest litigation filed by the Assam Public Works in the July of 2009. Since the July of 2009 till the 31st of July 2018, there have been 35 hearings in the Supreme Court. It's a continuing mandamus. The next one is coming up on the 16th of August 2018. With great respect to the Supreme Court, I would like to very, very humbly submit that they will apply, have to apply themselves to the consequences. That if, let's suppose, even one-tenth of those people, you know, who have been identified as non-Indians in the draft list, even if the number comes down, you know, to one-tenth of that, what are you going to do with them? Where are you going to send them? Who's going to take them? And so therefore, and then there's the politics of it, which is going to destabilize the entire Assam. It's going to disrupt the Northeast. And the one relationship that you have in your neighborhood, that is with Bangladesh, because all the rest have been ruined in the past 4 years, even that's going to get completely disrupted.
Okay, Mr. Nigam has a quick counter to what you have to say.
I was looking for an answer whether he agrees in principle or not. He is not. He went under the process. I presume he agrees in principle what NRC stands for, to discourage illegal immigration. Providing consular access to Indian citizens, even though they are trying to enter into US, this is a moral responsibility of the government of India. In this case, in Assam, it becomes a moral responsibility, of the Bangladeshi government here. If they are identified as Bangladeshi illegal immigrants, it is their responsibility, moral responsibility, to come.
But are they Bangladeshi? Is the government of Bangladesh accepting them as Bangladeshi, Mr. Nigam?
Please hold on,
The government of Bangladesh has already said
I did not interrupt Manish. I did not interrupt you, Manish. I did not interrupt you. You will have your chance. You will have your chance.
You will have your chance.
But let me complete for a second.
This is not the way I did it.
Identify themselves as Indians.
Okay.
Here they are not identifying themselves as Bangladeshis.
Exactly.
That's the difference.
Let the process be complete. Wait for the process. Don't prejudge the entire issue. That stage has not yet come.
But Amit Shah did prejudge it yesterday.
No. He has to wait. He has to wait till the final outcome.
I'm glad you're saying that.
Well, your president declared 40 lakh people
as ghoulpetias. Secondly, it is
even
being monitored.
Even before the process was complete.
That's exactly my point.
But
at least Mr. Nigam is accepting that that's not right.
The NRC coordinator, Pratik Hajina.
Even the mighty Amit Shah has to wait for a process to be complete.
The process is supervised by the Supreme Court and there will be an outcome of it. And at the same time, you have to discourage illegal immigration. How do you do that? It's become a serious problem. How you have to disincentivize this, that coming into India will not give you any incentive. Anybody who finally becomes an illegal immigrant has to be given a refugee status immediately. And they have to be taken care by government of India.
I think ultimately the important thing here is that genuine citizens should not suffer, but they are suffering. And that
Nidhi, may I come in for a minute?
Yeah, just
Nidhi, may
quickly,
I come in for
quickly.
A second?
Yes. Yes, Manish.
You know, how does this square up with the RSS conception of Akhand Bharat? So therefore, on one side, you talk about Akhand Bharat, you know, you talk about a borderless South Asia, and on the other hand, you take this stand. You can't run with the hare and hunt with the hound.
Let me respond to you. We are talking of borderless boundaries, not for illegal immigration. It is about trade. It is about tourism. Please understand, that's the distinction
that is what Akhand Bharat means.
That is what, in fact, is. In modern day,
that
you cannot.
That is what he's saying, it is tourism and trade. Okay, all right. Well, I have to leave it there. Like I said,
the
issue really is about about people. I mean, you should.
We have tourism and trade with Mongolia also.
Like,
that is also
like
Akhand
Mr.
Bharat.
Hark and Mr. Ahmed, who are on our show tonight.
Please don't trivialize the entire issue of NRC.
Indian citizens having served in the army and the air force, for God's sake, who are now running around finding their names that are not on the list and who, as per Amit Shah today, are ghuspet.
Kargil martyrs.
Yeah. So I mean, you know, let's just take a look at that and what this process is doing. It's not just anecdotal, as one person said yesterday. This is a serious matter that is affecting lives of people on the ground. Thank you to all of you for joining us.